What is up, everybody? Welcome on in to NHL Puckline. Lauren Jbara here with Drew Goldfarb, and it is a sad, sad day, but a very exciting day at the same time. It's the last day of the regular season in the National Hockey League, but it's the last show that we're having this season. Drew, how are we feeling? Happy final day.
Happy final day. Yeah, a little torn on it. It's nice to, you know, get into the postseason for the NHL. Always an exciting time of year, but in a way, it also kind of feels like December 26th, where we know that Christmas is the start of the next season of Puckline in the league is as far away from now as possible. But great playoff action to be able to just sit back and watch.
Yeah, we're excited. There's a lot of games on the slate tonight. And it's pretty crazy to think all Eastern Conference teams have finished their games. Now it's time for the Western Conference to wrap things up for the regular season. Six games on the slate tonight, and our Puckline fans, just because it is the final day of the season, we have you covered for all six of those games. The Kraken in Minnesota taking on the Wild. We have the Canucks also in Canada taking on the Winnipeg Jets. The Sharks taking on the Flames. The Oilers have landed in the Mile High City to go head-to-head against the Colorado Avalanche. The Ducks are in Sin City taking on the Vegas Golden Knights, and the Chicago Blackhawks finishing the season on the left coast, west coast, going head-to-head against the Kings. But let's start it out in Minnesota. The Seattle Kraken have made their way there to take on the Wild. Both teams at this point, Drew, they're just ready for the summer months. They're ready to hit the links. They're ready to get that golf swing going. For the Kraken, they're on a four-game skid, 4-6-0 in their last 10 games, sitting six in the Pacific right now, and offensively one of the bottom four teams in the league. They're averaging 2.59 goals per game. But I look at a guy like Jared McCann. He leads all scorers on the team with 61 points, 29 goals. He does only have 1 point in the last five games, but it's their last season, or their last game of the regular season. Summer's right around the corner. I feel like at this point, they're just kind of ramping down heading into the summer.
Yeah, and McCann still has an opportunity to hit 30 goals for the second time in his career. He's sitting at 29. He's basically been sitting at 29 because, as you mentioned, only 1 point in his last five games. It was his 29th goal of the season. He does have at least 1 point in four of his last seven on the road. That's two goals, two assists, 23 shots in those last seven away from Seattle, which is a nice split to see for a game like this, because overall in his last 18 games, he's only had at least 1.7 times. So he's found more success on the road here in the final month, month and a half of the regular season. And we'll see if he can get to the 30-goal mark in a game like this, going up against Marc-Andre Fleury, confirmed as the starter for Minnesota, as obviously that's a nice round number to end the year on. And considering that he hit 40 goals a year ago, I'm sure that getting out of the 20s and right to that 30 mark would be a positive way for him to end his season.
Yeah, I agree too. And I know this total is set at 5.5. It's because defensively, the Kraken, one of the top eight teams in the league, they're allowing only 2.83 goals per game. And I know a lot of that has been due to Joey Decord, the way that he's been playing this year. He's had a fabulous season, 916 save percentage, 2.45 goals against average. But you mentioned the Minnesota Wild. They're back at home for the final game of the regular season. They're six in the Central. They're ready for some R&R this summer, coming back rested and refreshed next year. They are on a two-game winning streak though, 5-4-1 in their last 10 games, but their offensive numbers, middle of the league, not good, but not bad. I know I look at a guy like Kirill the Thrill, who I feel like someone still needs to tell him that they're not in the playoffs, because he's just been crushing over the last few weeks, leading the team 95 points, 45 goals. But Matt Boldy, 67 points on the year, on a five-game point streak to finish out the season, 7 points, three goals during that span. Do you think he finishes the season, Drew, on a six-game point streak tonight?
I feel like he should. He's also sitting at 29 goals entering today, but unlike on the other side with McCann, it's because he has really ramped things up here in the last couple weeks of the regular season. Three goals, four assists in his last five games. Those were all road games, so obviously playing a home game tonight, but still at least 1 point in seven of his last 10 played at home. A very heavy split towards assists in that run. Three goals, eight assists, 29 shots in his last 10 home games. So the numbers that he's put up this season, really good, a new career high in assists, new career high in points. And if he can get one more today, he'd have 30. Two more would tie his career high of 31 goals if he can pick up a multi-goal effort to close out this campaign. But yeah, he's maybe a little late for the Minnesota Wild, obviously, since they're not going to be playing after today this season. But he's really come on here down the stretch.
I know he's been playing really, really well. I look at the Wild on the defensive side. They're middle of the league, allowing 3.16 goals per game. You mentioned Marc-Andre Fleury getting that start between the pipes tonight before he plays one more season next year as his final season in the National Hockey League. It's sad. I don't even know what the NHL is without Flower this year. But I'm looking at this line, the Minnesota Wild. They're decent favorites at home. I feel like there's not a ton of value to take them on the money line. But when I look at the total at 5.5, I feel like there's going to be under 5.5 goals scored. But maybe that's a little ambitious of me, because when a line is set so low, it always makes me a little bit nervous to bet the under. How do you feel about this line?
I would agree with you on that. The 5.5 in the modern NHL is always something that makes me a little suspicious of a line like that.
Yeah.
Money Puck, basically, if you're looking at their computer simulations, actually says that the Seattle side of the money line has a little plus EV in it, because the implied odds right around 43%. Money Puck says that they should win about 44.5% of the time. So plus 130 is basically, at the very least, it's fair value on Seattle. It's juice free. Whereas the Minnesota side, like you mentioned, minus 156. They've been, you know, they've won back-to-back games. They went 3-2-0 on their last road trip. So betting against them, against a team that's lost four in a row, is not always a good approach in a game like this. But the numbers say Seattle's side of the money line has value.
Yeah, it'll be a fun game to watch. Game one of this six-game slate, we have the Seattle Kraken in Minnesota taking on the Wild. You can watch that game at 7 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN. We'll head north of the border. Two Canadian teams going head-to-head. The Canucks have made their way to Winnipeg to finish out the season. Now, for the Canucks, they're the top team in the Pacific Division. 5-4-1 in their last 10 games. They are in a two-game winning streak, but their numbers have just been stellar all season long. Offensively, they're the sixth best team in the league. They're scoring just under 3.5 goals per game. And JT Miller, been that driving force to the offense this season. 103 points, 37 goals. And it's crazy because he's on an 11-game point streak right now. 14 points, 4 goals during that span. I think somebody, Drew, is ready for the playoffs. What do you think?
Yeah, this is the time of year you want to catch fire like he has done in the last few weeks, really. And it goes back beyond that, because he has at least 1 point in 22 of his last 25 games. So 11 straight. And then before that, 11 out of 14, he's had at least 1 point, 33 points. Pretty decently split, 13 goals, 20 assists in that stretch. New career high in goals already, new career high in points. I say already, there's literally 60 minutes of regular season action left for anybody to try and get a career number. But yeah, building off of that season a couple of years ago, he had 99 points. Last year, of course, he was a point per game player at 82. And here, with the run that he's had really in the last month or two of the season, makes him an interesting player to keep an eye out for going into the postseason. And basically, this is it doesn't really necessarily count in the standings, but this matchup here, I wonder how big of a playoff atmosphere we'll see between two teams that are each expecting deep runs after today ends.
Yeah, it really is going to be interesting to see. And I look at the Canucks. Yes, they're top six offensively. They're a top five defensive team. They've only been allowing 2.68 goals per game. And I know a lot of that due to Thatcher Demko. He was out for a month, at least over a month, actually, like 5 weeks, with a lower body injury. He did play Tuesday against the Flames, only allowed one goal. He's most likely going to be back tonight, just getting those reps for the regular season before he gets a lot of heavy workload during the playoffs. But he's playing to a .918 save percentage on the season, 2.43 goals against average. When I look at this line, seeing the Canucks as a slight underdog on the road, it's very tempting to take them plus money, because on the other side, I feel like I know why the line is leaning a little bit heavier towards the Winnipeg Jets. They're one of the hottest teams right now in the National Hockey League, second in the Central. They're on a 7-game winning streak right now. They've secured their playoff berth. Offensively, they're still middle of the league, averaging just about 3.15 goals per game. And I look at Kyle Connor. Yes, he missed a lot of the season. He missed about 20 games, but he has 61 points in 65 games this year. He's on an 8-game point streak to end the season right now. 12 points, 4 goals during that span. That's what you need from some of your top players. And then Mark Scheifele leads the team all season, 72 points for him. So you need some of your top guys to push this team forward. And we've seen that with the 7-game winning streak. I feel like this team just has Stanley Cup on their mind right now.
It'll be interesting to see what happens with the Winnipeg Jets going into the postseason, because they've been in previous years a team I've always looked at and been like, ooh, I think they could do something. This seems like that would be the case for the Jets this year. Kyle Connor, you mentioned the way that he has heated up going into the postseason as well with the numbers he's had. Because he did miss time, I think it's helpful at this point in the year to look at what his season statistics are if you were to extrapolate it to 80 games, if he had basically played the whole year. And his 80-game pace right now would be 42 goals, 33 assists, 75 points. So he's a basically a point-per-game player this season. He's getting a goal every other contest and a 40-goal scorer if he had been able to stay in the lineup the whole year. A year ago, he had set a career high in assists with 49. 42 goals, again, over 80 if he had played the full 80 games. Wouldn't be a career high, but it would be close because he did have a 47-goal season 2 years ago. Currently on an eight-game point streak for what he's been able to do here. And, you know, it's something that, especially if you're a fan of the Winnipeg Jets, you want to make sure that you're seeing these guys. We were talking about JT Miller on the Vancouver side, Kyle Connor here for Winnipeg. This is the time of year you want to get hot, and that's where both of those guys that we've been talking about here have been lately. And what Kyle Connor is going to be able to do to have those numbers for the regular season going into the playoffs, you know, does he get his 35th goal of the season tonight? Maybe. Could be interesting to see what happens there, but I'm sure that he'd rather score a goal later on and next week than here in game 82.
Yeah, playoffs right around the corner. It's pretty crazy. And I look at the Jets' defensive numbers, the second best team in the league. So these are two of the top five defenses in the NHL, which is why we're seeing the 5.5 in terms of the total line. But Connor Hellebuck not getting the start tonight. He gets a little bit of rest before the playoff starts. Laurent Brossoit is confirmed to get the start, playing to a .928 save percentage on the season. So when I look at this line, I know I said it again, the Winnipeg Jets are one of the hottest teams. They're like a train that you don't want to get in the way on the tracks for them right now because they're continuing to roll. But anytime you get the Vancouver Canucks at plus money, I feel like there's a value there to be able to take that, especially because they're a top six offensive team, a top five defensive team, and you have a guy like Thatcher Demko between the pipes. How do you feel about this line? Which way do you lean, Drew?
I agree with you. When I see a team that is a number one seed in their division at plus money, basically regardless of what the matchup is, as long as we're not expecting them to sit their entire top six and go to a third string goalie for the game, I think if you're looking at a game like this, plus 110 on Vancouver has a lot of value. If the line was reversed, I would be saying the same thing about Winnipeg. It's really that these are two very good teams. So the one that is offered with a higher potential payout for me is going to have more value.
Two good teams going head-to-head. Game two of the six-game slate, the Vancouver Canucks, also in Canada, staying in Canada, to take on the Winnipeg Jets. That game, 8 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN Plus and your regional sports networks. The Sharks are in Calgary to finish the season against the Flames. They played each other last week on Monday as well. Their second matchup in 11 days, but the last meeting was in San Jose. Now the Sharks are in Calgary. For the Sharks, they're 3-6-1 in their last 10 games. The last team in the National Hockey League, only 19 wins on the season, and offensively 31st in the league. I feel like I'm just like wah, wah, wah when I talk about the Sharks, but they were definitely sellers at the deadline. They're in a rebuilding mode next year. I feel like they can't wait to get to the summer fast enough, and next year is going to be their year to try to at least rebuild a little bit more. But a good piece for them, Mikael Granlund leads the team with 59 points. And Drew, he's on a 12-game point streak right now to end the season. 14 points during that span, two goals. That's exactly what he wants to do to gain that momentum heading into next year.
And I think it's added more impressive to see something like that because the Sharks have gone 4-20-4 in their last 28 games here, entering today in their final game of the season. So for Granlund to be able to put up the numbers that he's done in the last few weeks, I think is just really spectacular to see what he's done with that. His splits are interesting if you look before and since February 15th. Since then, 29 games played, 30 points. He's been a point-per-game player over the last 2 months. Prior to that, 39 games played, 29 points. So he has found a rhythm here since mid-February, literally the last 60, 65 days of the calendar where he has stepped things back up. And he's, you know, already surpassed his goal total from the last two seasons. His assist total is creeping up towards what he had had a couple of years ago when he was playing in Nashville. And so what he's doing here at the end of that season, it's good to see from a player that's playing on the San Jose Sharks, the team that, as you mentioned, 19 wins on the year. They're looking for just their 20th win on the season in game 82. So to see a guy producing that way is both nice to see from a team that is just not producing all season, and also going into the summer for a guy like him to have a bit more confidence in his game coming back next year, maybe getting bouncing back in the statistic categories going into the 2024-25 season. Wow, next year is going to be the 2024-25 season.
I know, isn't that crazy to think? I know, I feel old too. It's actually really, really crazy. But I know the Sharks can't wait for the summer right now, because I look at some of their defensive numbers. They're last in the league right now, allowing just about 4 goals per game. I don't know if we're going to get Mackenzie Blackwood or Devin Cooley tonight, but one of the two starting between the pipes. Now, on the other side, it is just the battle of the team between two teams that are looking forward to the end of the season. Calgary, fifth in the Pacific Division, 4-6-0 over their last 10 games. And offensively, they're middle of the league. They're averaging just over 3 goals per game. But Nazem Kadri leads the team with 75 points, 9 points in the last 5 games, including 4 goals. So Naz Kadri has figured something out to end the regular season. I know the first few months of the regular season, he really wasn't able to get much going, but over the last couple of months, he's figured out some sort of secret sauce that's really worked for him. 9 points in the last 5 games.
Yeah, 75 points for the year. His next goal would be his 30th of the season if he can get one today. And you mentioned the run he's been on, at least 1 point in 3 straight games, 9 of his last 11, with 10 assists and 6 goals in those last 11 games. He also has at least 1 point in 4 straight home games. And it's 4 goals, 4 assists, and 11 shots in his last 4 games played at the Saddle Dome in Calgary. So the run that he's been on here, his numbers in the goal column actually surpassing what he did with Colorado a couple seasons ago, although he has played 10 more games this year than he did in that season with the Avalanche when he had 87 total points. He hasn't been able to get the assist numbers like he did a couple of years ago, but those goal numbers are basically right around what you would want to see and hope to see from a guy like Kadri at this point in the season. Getting to that 30-goal plateau, again, been saying it for a couple of other players. It's a nice round number to end the season on and a good high note for him. So if he can go into the summer with a point in 4 straight and 10 out of 12 to close out the year, that's a really good thing for him going into the summer months and the golf courses before he comes back in the fall.
Yeah. That's pretty dang good for him. Defensively, 23rd in the league, allowing 3.28 goals per game. Jacob Markstrom most likely going to get the nod between the pipes, 905 save percentage. I know the San Jose Sharks, heavy, heavy underdogs in this game. Is there any value to squeeze out, or is this a game that we just watch and say, hey, can't wait to see these teams next season?
If you're going to look value, I would look for the team total goals bets individually, either an under for San Jose or an over for Calgary. A little tough on the over for Calgary, considering that they have only averaged basically 3 goals a game of offense this season, but the Sharks give up a lot. So that's kind of, if I'm going to try to look there, because I'm not taking a team like Calgary at minus 265. There is no matchup where I think that that has good value for a team that's fifth in the Pacific with less than 1 standings point per game played.
Yeah, I totally agree with you on that. We have the San Jose Sharks taking on the Calgary Flames. Another game on the 6-game slate tonight. You can watch it live 9 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN Plus or your regional sports networks. Let's head to the Mile High City. The Oilers have landed in Colorado to take on the Avalanche. For Edmonton, they're second in the Pacific Division, 5 points right now behind the Canucks. They locked in their playoff berth, 5-3-2 in the last 10 games. And offensively, they've just been a juggernaut for the second half of the regular season, the third best team in the league, averaging just about 3.6 goals per game. And we talk so much about the Connor McDavids of the world, 132 points, Leon Draisaitl with 106 points. But how about Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, 67 points on the year? We got to give him a little bit of love on the last day of the regular season. Only 3 points, though, in the last 5 games, but he's doing what he needs to do, at least contributing a little bit on the offensive side to help the team roll forward and be the third best offense in the NHL this season.
And we talked about a couple of players getting hot going into the playoffs or the offseason, depending on where their team lies in the standings. But for Nugent Hopkins, he's slowed down a little bit here in the last month, because you mentioned what he's done in the last few games. He has only at least 1 point in 3 of his last 11 games, 1 goal, 5 assists. So he's still getting a lot of points when he is getting points, but only 3 times in his last 11 games has he reached at least one, a couple of multi-point efforts in that stretch, however. So 18 goals, his next assist will be number 50 on the season if he can get one in tonight's game. And obviously for a team like Edmonton, they had been 4-1-1 in their last 6 games prior to last night's game in Arizona, where I think anybody outside of like a 30-mile or 50-kilometer radius of Edmonton was cheering for the other side in that matchup yesterday, in a game that they lost to the Arizona Coyotes. So Nugent Hopkins, it's, you know, some players are looking for that plateau, for that nice round number to close out the year. I think for him, it's important to make sure he's getting that offensive production headed into the postseason, because that depth is what's going to allow Edmonton to make a deep run into the playoffs. And you want to make sure you kind of shake a little bit of this last few weeks off if you're RNH heading into tonight's game.
Yeah, I agree with you too. And they've been relying a lot on the offensive side because they're third best, but defensively, they're still a top 10 team. Kelvin Pickard started last night. Stuart Skinner, probably going to be in net tonight, played to a .907 save percentage on the year. Now I look at the Avs. Yes, they're third in the Central, but they're kind of skidding into the playoffs right now. They're 3-5-2, Drew, in their last 10 games. I know they're going to want to end the season on a high note and get the win at home in front of a home crowd. They're on a two-game skid right now. Offensively, though, they haven't slowed down. They're the top team in the league. They're averaging 3.67 goals per game. And we mentioned how good of a season Nathan MacKinnon is having. 138 points, 51 goals, cannot slow him down. But Casey Mittelstadt, who was added to the team midseason, has 56 points on the year, but only one in his last five games. He is centering that second line. I feel like the team needs just a little bit more production from a guy like that. But he has been a good addition to this team, adding another piece of depth for what they hope to be a long playoff run this year.
And another guy like Ryan Nugent-Hopkins on the other side of things that is going to be looking to just get that rhythm back here going into the postseason, because he's been held without a point in five of his last seven games. Still decent numbers overall when you're looking at since he was acquired in that trade deadline trade, with 17 games, 9 total points. His first 10 games, though, since when he got to Colorado with the Avalanche, he had 4 goals and 3 assists. And since the trade overall, other than that, only 2 assists in his last 7 games. And only 8 shots on goal as well. So those numbers have been down a little bit. If he can find whatever that rhythm was that he found in the first 3 weeks playing with the Colorado Avalanche again, that is going to help them with their depth scoring. It's going to help them be the dangerous team we all know the Colorado Avalanche are expected to be and should be in the postseason. So curious to see the two players we're talking about for this game, which one of them is able to have a bit more production going into and closing out game 82, so that when they're playing postseason game number 1 and their 83rd game that counts for the season, that this way they've got a bit more of that momentum going, if you enjoy the word that starts with an M. I know some people don't like to use that word, but that momentum is an important thing, I think, for a player going into the postseason here.
I agree, too. And when you have a top offensive team, you have to help them stay in that top spot offensively. Now, defensively for the Avs, they are middle of the league. They're allowing 3.10 goals per game. Still no confirmation if it's going to be Justus Nunin or Alexander Georgiev in net tonight. But I look at a total for a game like this set at 6.5. You have the number one offense going up against the number 3 offense in the National Hockey League. I have to say it's going to go over 6.5 goals, Drew. How do you feel about the total in this game?
I would lean that way as well, since this is the last day of the regular season. And I mean, these points are not completely meaningless in the grand scheme of things, because if these two teams were to meet in the Western Conference Final, they're currently separated by 1 standings point, with Colorado having that edge. So I do think an over is a good way to play it. Again, going to the computer simulations, the odds that you're seeing on Edmonton, basically juice-free at +136. That is a pretty fair price for what the Oilers should be doing in a game like this against Colorado. So an over makes sense to me. Again, like we talked about the last game or 2 games ago now, if you want to go to the underdog, the visitor side, because I think there's some decent value there. Colorado -164, as you know, it's game 82. That's not going to really interest me here when they're not in a must-win situation.
Yeah, I'm excited to just watch this game, a battle between 2 very, very good teams in the Western Conference. We have the Edmonton Oilers going head-to-head in the Mile High City against the Colorado Avalanche. You can catch that game live 9:30 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN. Let's take you out to Sin City, where Drew and Todd both live. The Ducks are there to finish out the season. And for Anaheim, they're second to last in the Pacific. They're on a 2-game skid. They're 2-7-1 in their last 10 games. They're just ready to hit the links, go golfing, and they're ready for next season at this point. Offensively, they're the 30th team in the league, averaging under 2.5 goals per game. But Frank Vetrano, he's been solid for this team all season long. 57 points, 34 goals. 4 goals, though, in his last 4 games, Drew. You talk about that momentum. Frank Vetrano has that, but his team isn't going to the playoffs this year.
It's not, but it's not because of anything he has or has not done, because he's already got a career high in goals and assists, 34 goals. If he can get one tonight, that would be 35. 23 assists on the year, 57 points, 268 shots on goal. That's new career high, new career high, new career high, new career high. And what he's been able to do with the Ducks, and seeing that growth that he has had since he was acquired by them, you go back 2 seasons, he played for the Panthers and Rangers, 32 points in 71 games. Last year, first one with the Ducks organization, 41 points in 81 games. This year, through 81 games, 57 points. So he has taken steps up over the last three seasons. And, you know, when you're the Anaheim Ducks and you're playing for the Anaheim Ducks in a year like this with what they've done or have not done standings wise this season, being able to take another step forward and improve year to year is really what you want to see out of a guy like him, because, you know, the Anaheim Ducks have a lot of decisions that they've got to make this offseason to see what direction they're going to take in the fall and to see how quickly they feel that they can rebound. The Toronto 57 points, career highs across the boards in basically every statistical category that you would track for a guy like him, is making the case that he should be a really integral part of a team success moving forward.
I totally agree with you on that. He's been a very, very fun player to watch this season. And last time I checked, when you have career highs in basically every statistical category, it means it's a good year for you. But defensively for the team, it wasn't a good year. They're 30th in the league, just like they are on offense. They're allowing 3.6 goals per game. I know John Gibson most likely to get the nod between the pipes to finish out the regular season, playing to an .887 save percentage. But I look at the team on the other side for Vegas. They've been battling all season long. And a lot of the time, yes, they're battling themselves, but they're battling injuries for majority of the season. They still earn themselves a playoff berth. They're third in the Pacific Division, 6-3-1 in their last 10 games. Currently on a 3-game winning streak. So that's a good way to end the regular season, hoping to end it on a 4-game winning streak heading into the playoffs. But offensively, 11th best team in the league, averaging just about 3.25 goals per game. And Jonathan Marchessault, since Mark Stone has gone down, has really stepped up his game to another level. He leads the team with 69 points, maybe wanting to end in that 70-point-ish area. Also a team-high 42 goals on the year. He has 3 points in his last 5 games, but he's a guy that's really taken a lot of what this team's been dealing with on his back and helped push them forward to where they are in the standings right now. Because about a week ago, they were like maybe even almost out of playoff contention at that point too. So it's interesting to see what they've been able to do with injuries all season long and still end up third in the division this year.
Yeah, their arena sits right behind the New York Hotel, which has one of the basically the roller coaster in Las Vegas, the New York coaster that's right there. So that's been a pretty decent description of how the Golden Knights season has gone in the last couple of months. Just lots of up and downs. There's actually a Heartline roll on that roller coaster, which, if you're a Knights fan, you've been following along the last few weeks. That's pretty accurate, I think, of a description of how you've been feeling looking at the standings. Marchessault, you mentioned, though, the career high in goals, 42. He has been such a big part of the identity of this franchise since it came into existence. He's an original misfit. He had a really great first year. He, of course, won playoff MVP last year as the Golden Knights won the Stanley Cup against my Panthers. And he's done really well, but this in the last 6 games here, only at least 1 point in 3 of them, 1 goal, 2 assists. So if he can get one more, he hits that 70-point mark, which would be really nice for him. And again, nice round numbers on that. But really, it's just making sure he's got the rhythm going into the postseason, because he is such a big part of this team's identity. And this is the last year of his contract. Yeah. So it's going to be interesting to see where he ends up playing in the fall. But I'm sure he's hoping to get at least 16, if not 17 more wins with the Golden Knights before he has to concern himself with the goings-on of July 1st.
Yeah, I totally agree with you on that. And I was going to say, thankfully, this team is healthier because only Mark Stone's left on IR. But then you look at who's day-to-day. I know William Carrier, Alex Pietrangelo have been day-to-day for about a week now. But Chandler Stephenson, Anthony Mantha were also added to that list, too. So just when we think they're getting healthier, they get hit with another set of injuries. But defensively, they're still upper middle of the league, allowing just under 3 goals per game. And the good news for them, Aiden Hill, who has been in and out basically all season long, confirmed to get the start tonight. Another rep for him before heading into the playoffs, playing to a .910 save percentage. Now, there really isn't any value when you look at Vegas on the money line. You basically have to lay $4 just to get them to win the game. How do you squeeze value out of this game? Or is it just one that you watch as a Vegas Golden Knights fan?
I'm going to take Vegas. I'm going to buy 2 goals of insurance and just take a -1200. No, I'm not going to do that, obviously. If you're looking at the puck line option, you're right around -140 at last glance to take Vegas to win by at least 2 goals, which is something they should do against the Anaheim Ducks. And if you wanted to get that even closer to even money, you could probably parlay that with just about any player on either team for at least 2 shots on goal. So if that's what it takes to make it interesting, to basically take Vegas to win by multiple goals and combine it with anyone, if you want to take Petrano, if you want to take Marchessault, if you want to take any other player on either team for at least 2 shots, that'll get you right around the even money mark. And other than that, I mean, you know, sit back and watch this. Though this is an important game for Vegas because they're still playing for seeding. They cannot afford to leave both points on the table against the Ducks in a game like this, because you know, I guess depending on who they'd prefer for a round one matchup. But if you want that better seed, win and you clinch it.
Yeah, I know. They really, really want to get the dub in this one, finish the game on a four-game winning streak. We have the Anaheim Ducks in Sin City taking on the Vegas Golden Knights. That game on at 10 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN Plus and your regional sports networks. Last but not least, game six of the six-game slate. The Blackhawks are on the West Coast to finish out the season against the LA Kings, the team that's also trying to win to get better seeding this year. So we'll see how what ends up happening here. But for Chicago, they're also ready for the offseason, but we all knew this heading into the year. They're rebuilding. They had Connor Bedard, and he's basically finishing his first year on an absolute high. They're last, though, in the Central Division, pushing towards next season. They're on a five-game skid, 3-7-0 in their last 10 games. And offensively, they're the last team in the league. They're averaging just about 2.15 goals per game. But I feel like the biggest bright spot for this Blackhawks team this season has been the play of Connor Bedard. He's been so much fun to watch. And I feel like just as a hockey fan, you love watching a new face come into the league and just dominate in every category in terms of rookie stats. 61 points on the year, 22 goals, despite missing some time. We all forget he broke his jaw. He had his jaw literally sealed shut for about a month. Only 2 points in his last five games, though. But everything that Connor Bedard has done this season, just for the game of hockey, has been so much fun to watch. And I'm excited to see him play for years to come.
100%. It's going to be a great watch for him. And this is, you know, a good experience to get into the NHL, have a really strong rookie season, dealt with that adversity with that injury that he had. I think it's important because of that to kind of put his numbers in a context of the team he's on. Because even with missing those games, about 14 games that he missed, he has 61 points. The Blackhawks only have 174 goals scored on their own. So he has been part of more than a third of all, if my math is right, more than a third of all, about 35% of Chicago's goals this total, despite the fact that he missed 14 games. So if you take his numbers and you love the word extrapolate for some reason at 9 o'clock in the morning Pacific time, but over 82 games, that's 75 points that he has generated if he had been healthy the whole year. 75 out of 174 would be what we would be expecting for Bedard if he had been healthy the whole year. You're talking about over 40% of all goals scored by the Chicago Blackhawks he has had at least a hand in, whether it's part of his 22 goals that he's got this season, part of his 39 assists. He could hit 40 if he picks up another one here tonight. Difficult matchup to do that in, but if Chicago's going to get a point, it's probably going to touch the stick of Connor Bedard before it ends up in the back of the net.
I know. I totally agree with you. He's been so much fun to watch this season, and I know he's getting ready for the offseason, but he can hang his hat on a really, really awesome rookie year that we've all enjoyed watching. Now, for the Blackhawks defensively, not very good. 29th in the league. They're allowing 3.5 goals per game. I know Peter Mrazek most likely to get the start between the pipes tonight, playing to a .907 save percentage. I will say he's allowed 3 or less goals in each of his last 7 starts, and 4 of those, he's allowed only 2 goals, which has been pretty, pretty impressive for the way that this defensive core on this Blackhawks team has been playing, and they've dealt with injuries all season long. Now, on the other side, the Kings locked in their spot into the 2024 playoffs, but with a win, they maybe could improve in their seeding, surpassing the Vegas Golden Knights. So it'll be interesting to see. They sit fourth in the Pacific right now, 5-5-0 in their last 10 games. Offensively, middle of the league, scoring just over 3 goals per game. And I know Adrian Kempe tied for the team lead with 73 points. Kevin Fiala is his running mate with also 73 points on the year, 29 goals, 5.3 goals in the last 5 games. The LA Kings have been above mid this season, but I feel like right now they need a win tonight to really get that momentum going for themselves into the playoffs, because about a week ago, they were sitting in that number 3 spot in the division, and they kind of like let it falter and drop a little bit.
Them in Vegas have just been dancing in the standings for the last few months. Yeah. Just do-si-do and switching positions in the standings, where one's a wild card team, one's a 3 seed. It's just the way it's been going for them. They have won 5 out of 7, and you mentioned Fiala with what he's been able to do lately. He has at least 1 point in 11 of his last 15 games, evenly split, 8 goals, 8 assists in his last 15. And those stats over the course of 82 games would have him as a point-per-game player, would have him at 40 goals and 40 assists. 2 years ago was his best statistically career season, 33 goals, 52 assists when he was playing with Minnesota. So the run that he's had here entering the postseason would be the best run of his career, the best season of his career, if it had lasted more than the last 15 games. And if he can keep it going for the next 15 games, I'm sure he'll trade 15 or 20 points in the regular season for a few extra games to be able to play in the postseason. But yeah, This is a game that LA should win. They should get those 2 points. If Vegas also gets their 2 points, it's not going to matter what LA does in this game, but it's going to start at the same time. Mm-hmm. So unless we see a coach pull their goaltender in the end of regulation or something with a tie game, then it's going to come down to if Vegas can win, they're in that spot. If not, LA's got a shot at it. And since I know we're going to go there in a second, if you parlay the money line for both Vegas and LA, if you're trying to find a bit of value, that's minus 168 that they both win, which is basically the same as taking either of them puck line. So looking for a bit of value, I wanted to do a little digging there while you were setting me up here to talk about Kevin Fiala. That's what I came across, minus 168 for both Vegas and LA to win their games tonight, both of whom should pretty easily be able to deal with the teams they've been scheduled with for game 82.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how this one plays out. But the Kings obviously want to get a win against one of the bottom teams in the NHL. And I look at their defensive prowess numbers. They're third best in the league, allowing 2.5 goals per game. I don't know if it's going to be Cam Talbot starting or David Rittich, and giving Talbot a little bit of rest before the playoffs start. But both of them good options, both playing to above a .915 save percentage on the season. But that's how you squeeze value out of this game, Drew. I appreciate it, because the last two games, really, really heavy money line favorites. So parlay two really good teams against two really bad teams. I like it a lot. We have the Kings playing at home against the Chicago Blackhawks to finish out the regular season. That game on at 10:30 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN Plus in your regional sports networks. Let's cycle through the other games we chatted about today. The Kraken in Minnesota going head-to-head against the Wild. Both of their seasons are done after this game, 7 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN. Then we have the Canucks taking on the Winnipeg Jets, 8 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN Plus. And your regional sports networks, the Sharks in Calgary going head-to-head against the Flames, 9 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN Plus and your regional sports networks. Then the Oilers in the Mile High City on the second half of a back-to-back taking on the Avs, both teams trying to get a little momentum heading into the playoffs. That game on at 9:30 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN. And then the Ducks in Sin City taking on the Vegas Golden Knights. That game on at 10 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN Plus and your regional sports networks. Now, I know we promised everyone it, our same game parlay standings. It's been a long time coming, Drew, about 8 months of regular season action. We've had a same game parlay every single week throughout the regular season. Drum roll. Let's see who finished on top. You, me, or Tom Vecchio. And we all know the answer to this one, because it's you. You finished at plus 407. I lost my same game parlay last week and this week, which makes me deep, deep, deep in the red. I'm so sad. I had an opportunity to finish in the green, but you know what? At least I wasn't last, like Tom. But they say, Ricky Bobby said, if you ain't first, you last. Drew, you take home the SGP crown, SGP king. How does it feel?
It feels good. Should I just give the producers my address? Is there like a bonus? Do I get like an extra $400? Is that what that results in? I mean, I would have been even more upset if that was the case, with how my parlay yesterday went, because nearly hit that 10-1 too, which I was only missed on one leg. And, you know, It doesn't count for anything officially, but, you know, Arizona did score a goal 1 second after the end of the first period, and the only bet I missed was there being a goal in the first 10 minutes of the second period. So I'm not saying that at 20:01 of the first is the same as 0:01 of the second, but that was just how close that came to being $1,500 in the green.
You know what, Drew Goldfarb takes home the crown, same game parlay champion. And I want to give a thank you to all of our Puckline fans all season long. It's been such a fun season, 4 shows every single week for the entirety of the regular season. So from myself, Drew Goldfarb, Todd Fuhrman, and our entire crew, production crew behind the scenes, we want to thank you guys for tuning in. We can't even wait for playoffs, baby. Until next season, we'll see ya. Peace.